टुडेज टॉपिक ऑफ डिस्कशन इज सुपरकोंडाइलर फ्रैक्चर्स इन द चिल्ड्रन. सुपरकोंडाइलर ह्यूमरस फ्रैक्चर्स इन द चिल्ड्रन आर द मोस्ट कॉमन फ्रैक्चर्स ऑफ द एल्बो. मीन एज इज द 5 to 7 ईयर्स ऑफ एज एंड इट्स कॉमन इन बॉयज. सो द फर्स्ट केस इज 7 ईयर्स ओल्ड boy presented to ER with a history of fall with an outstretched hand, deformity of the elbow and the pallor of the hand. And so here is the two radiographs. The one is the oblique view and the one is the lateral view. How will you proceed with this case? First, we will do the physical examination. On the inspection, we will find the gross deformity, swelling, ecchymosis in the antecubital fossa, limited range of motion, and neurovascular examination reveals a interior intraosseous nerve neuropyrexia, and the patient will be unable to flex the interphalangeal joint of the thumb and the distal interphalangeal joint of the index finger. Patient will be unable to make the OK sign, and there will also be the median nerve injury, the loss of sensation over the volar index finger, and there will be also a radial nerve injury, inability to extend the wrist, metacarpophalangeal joint, thumb interphalangeal joint, but PIP and DIP can still be extended by the intrinsic function of the ulnar nerve. We will also assess for the vascular perfusion. If there is a well perfused arm, it will be warm and the pink, and when it's poorly perfused, it will be cold, pale, and the capillary refill time will be greater than 2 seconds. After the physical examination, you will order the radiographs, AP and the lateral view of the elbow joint. And on the radiographs, 3 signs will be positive: posterior fat pad sign, sail sign, displacement of interior humeral line, alteration of the Bowman's angle. So here are the 2 radiographs. The first one is showing the fat pad sign posteriorly and the sail sign interiorly. And the second is the deformed interior humeral line, in which the capitulum moves posteriorly to this reference line extension type fractures and interiorly in the flexion type of fractures. So this picture is showing that Bowman's angle. The normal Bowman's angle is 72 to 75 degrees, and but in deviation of greater than 5 to 10 degree indicates the coronal plane deformity. In the radiograph, you have to keep in mind the different ossification centers, the capitulum at the 1 year of age, the radial hand and the medial epicondyle ossification at the 4 to 5 years of age, trochlear and olecranon process at the 8 to 9 years of age, and the lateral condyle appear at the 10 years of age. Now come to the classification of the supracondylar fracture of the humerus. So the classification is the Gartland's classification. The type 1 is non-displaced. The type 2 is further classified into A and a B. In A type, it's intact posterior cortex, hinged extension, no rotation or the translation. In the type 2B, intact posterior cortex, hinged extension with some degree of rotational displacement or the translation. And the type 3, there is a complete displacement. So these are the 4 radiographs which is showing the Gartland's classification. The type 1 in which there is no displacement, in the type 2 and there is a posterior cortex is intact but there is no obvious displacement, and the type 2B when there is an obvious displacement but posterior cortex remain intact, and in the type 3 when there is a complete displacement. So how will you manage the patient? Type 1 is usually treated with the cast immobilization for 3 to 4 weeks with the radiograph in the first week, and it should be repeated every week to see the progression. The type 2 is usually treated via the closed reduction percutaneous pinning. The first reduce the fracture, then K wires placed from the lateral condyle in the superior medial direction via the 2 pins with the maximal spread at the fracture site. The first pin, more medial of the 2 pins, enters through the capitulum for the bicortical fixation and goes from the interior to posterior for the more fixation. Bend wires at least 1 centimeter off to the skin to allow for swelling, then cut off the wires with the 1 to 2 centimeter exposed. So here is the picture showing the CRPP. So what is the treatment of the type 3 or the type 4 Gartland's classification? So the most commonest approach in the children is a posterior lateral approach to the elbow. Simply skin incision 10 centimeter proximal to elbow on the posterior lateral aspect of the arm and continue distally for the 13 centimeter. Dissection through the fascia and expose the aponeurosis of the tricep as far as distally at the insertion on the olecranon process. Free the aponeurosis proximally, two distally in a tongue-shaped flap and retract it distally to its insertion. Elevate the periosteum with the tricep muscle from the posterior surface of the distal humerus for the size 5 cm. Strip the periosteum from the bone as conservatively as possible because serious damage to the blood vessel can occur, which cause the osteonecrosis. Head of the radius lies in the distal end of the wound. When the elbow has been fixed in the complete extension with the contracted tricep muscle, it should be flexed to the right angle for the wound closure. So here is a pictorial representation of the posterior lateral approach. The first diagram is showing the incision. The second one is showing the separation of the tricep tendon from the humerus. And the C1 is the showing the tongue-shaped raised flap of tricep muscle. Now come to the complications. There are three main complications: the malunion, ischemic contracture, and damage to the nerve. The malunion resulting in the cubitus varus position, the varus deformity of the elbow known as Gunstock deformity. Ischemic contracture, the Wolfman ischemic contracture due to the damage or the occlusion of the brachial artery resulting in the volar compartment syndrome. And during the procedure, there can be damage to the ulnar nerve, median nerve, or the radial nerve. And the least commonest complication is the osteonecrosis.